Greetings, wrestling fans of the world, and welcome to the Flying Gaijin Bombcast. Coming to you from the sunny shores of Fort Lauderdale, Florida, I am your host, Zachary Randall. And with me, as always, my co-host, he is a B-plus podcaster, Mad Matt Thompson.
Ouch.
Maddie, how you doing?
I'm doing all right. You know, things have been all right this week. Been recovering from a cold since Friday night. Went to the movies with my girlfriend. We went and saw the new Beauty and the Beast, and it was a great movie, and we had great seats. We actually spent a little extra, got reclining leather chairs front and center, best seats in the house.
That's a fancy-ass date night right there.
I do what I can. Well, we were going to go to dinner afterwards, but in the middle of the movie, I started getting a really intense fever and felt like a douche. But I mean, like, I just, you know, I was not up for it. I felt like absolute dog shit. So
you had to tap out.
Yeah, alas. But yeah, I mean, the movie was great. I can't believe I'm doing this, but I'm highly recommending a Disney movie and a musical. So yeah, I don't know what the hell's happened to me, but
I tell you what happened to you. You got a girlfriend.
Yeah, that's true.
That's what happened. Speaking of movies, have you seen Logan?
I have not.
Holy shit, dude. So we saw that my birthday weekend, actually on opening night. First of all, it's the best. You and I could shoot a movie on our iPhones and make a better movie than the other Wolverine movies. Hands down, the best Wolverine movie. Probably the best X-Men movie, too. And what's awesome is that it stands on its own as just an awesome movie, period. Never mind that it's like a comic book thing. It was killer. It was emotional. You know, we cry a little bit, you know. You know, it's interesting I'm going to get on a little bit of a rant. Now, this is going to be maybe a little hypocritical because I am sort of by default a critic since I sit here and criticize wrestling on my podcast. But I've sort of reached a point that I'm over critics a little bit. One of the reviews of this movie I saw said something about how, well, you know, it would have made the movie perfect if, the, you know, there's nobody using superpowers in it. And it's like, motherfucker, it's a fucking superhero movie. And you don't think there should be powers being used in it?
What? It
makes no sense. The thing is why I don't like hearing people talk about my interests, and my interests are all a little bit niche. I guess a lot of this stuff has gone mainstream because, you know, okay, so I'm like into wrestling, I'm into video games, I'm into heavy metal. And when people start talking about that stuff, it just inevitably annoys me. Because whatever with wrestling, you know, everybody's, you know, people, like, you're almost everybody's a wrestling fan, even if they don't want to admit it. And here's why. You either grew up and watched, like, your local territory in the 70s or 80s, so you had this, like, local promotion that you were really attached to, and, you know, might have been awesome if it was, like, Jim Crockett or Georgia Championship Wrestling or Championship Wrestling from Florida. Or you came into it like I did with Rock and Wrestling, or you came into it like you did with the Attitude Era. So you have, like, three generations of people that experience, like, kind of awesome eras of wrestling. So everybody's a fan, but there's part of that fandom is like, well, yeah, but I'm not supposed to take it seriously. All right, so when you move on to, like, the comic book stuff, you know, so comic book movies, they're genre movies. And I've realized that a lot of people don't get genre movies. And you know what? You're going to have your fucking tropes in genre movies, and there's, like, no getting around it. Part of it is when the heroes meet for the first time, they're not going to get along. They're going to fight stupidly. And, oh, by the way, superheroes are going to use superpowers.
So it's, yeah, that's just, yeah, what would you expect? I mean, that's a really dumb opinion. For what it's worth, my brother Mike, my younger brother, he went and saw it. I think he said it made him tear up too. One of my buddies from college, Eric, he said the same thing. I mean, he said it was a great movie, said it, you know, gave him some feels. So
yeah. It was an amazing flick. And it was a nice kickoff to the birthday weekend.
Awesome. Yeah, I'd highly recommend Get Out, too, if you haven't seen that yet. It's pretty dope.
I've seen the trailers for that. That looks really interesting.
Yeah.
So, Maddie, past week, kind of a big week for New Japan Pro Wrestling. We had the semifinals and the finals of the New Japan Cup. So you want to talk about that a little bit?
Sure, absolutely. So we had, we had the second round matchups that we didn't get to last week, which were Juice Robinson and Shibata. First off, Shibata, dominated Juice Robinson in that one pretty easily there, made pretty quick work of him. More or less to be expected. I mean, Juice is on the come up. He's doing good things, but he's not on Shibata's level yet. So makes sense. And then the last one that we had was Ishii versus Sonata. That was another great match. Each guy pretty much got all their shit in, as it were. And yeah, Ishii came out on top, which is yet again what was the expected outcome. So then we had the semifinals. We had Evil versus Bad Rack. That was
Padraig
Bad
Waray.
Rack Waray.
That's not going to stop
Yes.
being funny.
No, it's never. So yeah, that was I don't know what to really say about it. I mean, I really like Evil's spots that he does, especially like that chair thing that he does where he wraps the chair around his opponent's neck and then whacks it with another one, like a big baseball swing. It's a really cool evil maneuver.
If you
Pretty
will.
da yeah, pretty dastardly little trick there.
Have you seen Evil's
So
t-shirts, by the way? He's got some of like the cooler New Japan t-shirts.
Evil stuff? No, I've looked up like the LIJ group t-shirts. I like those a lot.
Yeah,
I like the Destino one.
so Evil's shirts are like super fucking metal, which you would expect, because I mean his name is Evil.
Yeah, I'll have to check that out. Yeah, especially if you link me, that would be pretty dope. So yeah, Fale does his thing with the big man moves, and I'm pretty sure that at one point Evil was, looking like he was gonna win. He had him in the STO, that he calls Evil, that finish, and Fale starts elbowing the shit out of the back of his head, and it starts to turn things around. I think he spears him. All that good stuff runs through all his finishing sequence moves. I think he finished him with a grenade, but don't hold me to that. So yeah, pretty decent matchup. I was pretty surprised that Fale came out on top. I mean, I wasn't expecting him to push him this hard, but that's their prerogative, I guess. I mean, he's a big dude, and they kind of need a big dude who's positioned highly on the card to make the other underdogs look good,
Yeah, I was going to
and
say
they go over.
after you see the final, I think it makes sense why they put Fale in that spot, but we'll get to that in a minute.
So then we had Ishii versus Shibata. Holy shit. What else can I say? I mean, that was, if you've seen their previous matchups, go back to, I think it was Wrestle Kingdom 10 when they took each other on for the Never Openweight belt. Those were brutally stiff contests. This one was as well. And trying to think of how it ends. I'm pretty sure that Shibata was up in the vertical suplex position, getting ready to get the vertical drop brainbuster hit on him, and then he slides out the back door, puts the sleeper hold on him, and he sets him up for the PK. That's his traditional setup for the penalty kick finisher,
I
and
love
hits
that
him
he
with it,
does that, by
covers
the
him.
way. I mean, that's like a really cool setup for a finisher, and I don't know that I've ever seen anybody do quite that thing. You get the guy weak, you basically get the guy knocked out with a sleeper hold. Then when he's sitting down in his ass, you just punt him in the fucking face.
Yeah, pretty wicked. And it totally fits his style. He does a lot of, shoot holds. He does a lot of really strong strikes. So that's a finish that really incorporates both, really effectively. So that's fucking dope. Shibata moves on to the finals. Takes on good old Bad Rack. And I mean, what else? Like Bad Rack just dominated probably 70, 80% of the offense in that match, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, it was definitely him dominating. It was what I would call a sort of a typical big man little man match. And mind you, Shibata's not little. Shibata's probably taller than I am, or like the same height as I am. But Fale's a pretty legit giant, so it was kind of him doing the beat down. Now the downside of that is that Fale is not a good wrestler. I guess maybe he's competent, but he's not a good wrestler. So the match wasn't super until Shibata started firing up, and then it got awesome.
Yeah, just you know, to further your point, I mean, the match had a lot of bells and whistles in it to accommodate Fale, and you know, it starts out with some outside brawling pretty much right from the get go. You know, the whole spot of Fale setting up Shibata to get counted out so that he can get the easy win. And of course, you know, Shibata runs in at about an 18 count. You know, Japan has a 20 count, so he slips in right as the referee's finishing up that count.
And I really like that spot, showing that spirit to get back in the ring.
Yeah, absolutely. Did correct me if I'm wrong, but doesn't Fale take a piece of guardrail and close the whole thing off so that Shibata has to jump over it to get into? So, you know, a little bit of resourcefulness coming from Fale. Pretty ingenious spot, to be honest. So yeah, you know, you have all that. You have just a lot of typical big man offense from Fale, and you know, sort of plotting, sort of methodical. And then Shibata ends up firing up at the end. It was really cool how he does the same setup as we had in the last match, more or less. Fale has Shibata up in the razor's edge position. Easy for me to say. So he calls it the bad luck fall, his finish. It's a big razor's edge style powerbomb. And he has him up in that sort of T position with both of his arms. And then Fale spins around and, you know, latches on the sleeper hold, gets Shibata down on his ass, sitting down position, knocked out PK, and then he reapplies the sleeper hold and makes him pass out completely to win the match. So he makes sure that he really puts the guy away and, you know, leaves no margin for error as far as, you know, winning the match. And then he cuts a little post-match promo. There's a suspense of which title he's going for, and obviously, not being fluent in Japanese, I'm not sure what he's saying, and he's sort of, you know, being around the bush for a couple minutes, and at the very end, he yells, Okada! And, you know, there we go, there's our answer. So, coming up towards the, you know, the beginning third of next month, I think it's April 9th, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, at Sakura Genesis.
Yeah, we're going to have that matchup, and that should be really fun to look forward to.
So, it was what was cool about the match is I think they got Shibata over in the way that they wanted. He's resilient. He's something of a giant killer. He showed great fighting spirit. So I think, I don't know. I speculated last week, sort of my dream scenario is Shibata going over in that match and then flipping the title over to Kenny Omega in like short order, either doing that match in the U.S. where Kenny Omega wins the IWGP title in the U.S. Because I don't think you want to do Kenny beating Okada in the U.S. I mean, I would fucking love that, since hopefully I'm going to be there. Mm-hmm. Or they switch the title, you know, maybe like in May or June before the U.S. shows. I don't know that that's the case, though. I mean, presumably the collision course, either later this year in New Japan or at the Dome next year, is a return match between Omega and Okada, one would think.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that, you know, another good point that you've made before is that the way they've been protecting that one-winged angel finish from Omega is, you know, I would really, really love to see him finally hit that on Okada at one point to win the title again. So, I mean, I don't know if that's going to necessarily be the case, but, you know, that would be my ideal situation for that to happen.
I think that's very clearly what they're doing. How about that? Yeah. They protect their finishers.
Yeah, it's a novel concept for sure.
I mean, Kenny Omega kicking out of the Rainmaker was a big, big deal. Listen to Jim Ross's call of that match, and you can tell, you know, it's a big, big deal.
Was that a sneak diss at Kevin Kelly and Don Callis?
Well, it wasn't Don Callis. It was Steve Corino.
Oh, whatever. Same deal.
It's not even a sneak diss. I mean, we can't even pretend that Jim Ross isn't. 1,000 times better than Kevin Kelly is. Jim Ross is the best ever, hands down. You know, obviously, you'd put a Lance Russell or a Gordon Solie up there with him. I don't necessarily really enjoy Solie's style that much, but he took it seriously, and he's considered a legend. I think, you know, for my wrestling fandom, Jim Ross is the best ever, and I don't even have anybody else that I think is close, you know?
I really like Mauro Ranallo. I mean, I don't know how much you caught of his access, New Japan work before JR came in, but I thought he did a really great job with that product. So
I love Mauro. He doesn't have the body of work yet. And being good for a little bit of time, okay, cool. But, you know, JR has years and years and years of amazing calls. So, you know, Mauro can get there, but he's not there. That's all I'm saying.
And who knows how many people even watched, like, you know, I think Mauro used to do Stampede Wrestling out of Calgary, like, when they did their relaunch or whatever, which, you know, didn't really last too long. It wasn't a very popular product, but, you know, I guess it's something. It's more than nothing, but, yeah, I don't really know. And, you know, a lot of his time, Mauro's, that has been spent calling other, you know, shoot combat sports, too. So, you know, I always thought he was great when he would do Strikeforce fights. To you, for what it's worth. So yeah, but yeah, I mean, getting back to the matchups and everything, I totally agree with all your statements about Shibata. You know, the match really made him look strong, taking all that punishment from Fale, and you know, he had a lot of rest holds, a lot of Fale working over Shibata's shoulder, which was taped up before the match. You know, and then. It was a lot to come back from, and Shibata rather did a great job at it. So,
and by the way, dude, Don Callis just sucks the fucking life out of those matches. Like, I'm not a Kevin Kelly fan, but I can get by with him. Like, I don't like when him, it was him and Romero. Like, I don't think Romero's great or even good. It was acceptable. Let's call it that.
Oh yeah,
I don't like Callis. I don't like anything about I would consider myself pretty monotone, so maybe I shouldn't talk. He's dull and monotone. He thinks he's being witty and he's not, and he's also just trying to get himself over.
Yeah, that's the thing that really bugs the shit out of me. It seems like he goes into business for himself more often than not. And it's like, dude, like, nobody fucking cares. Like, you're not nearly as cool as you think you are, and you're not nearly as funny or clever as you think you are either. So you really need to fucking stop. Like, that's it. Like, I don't know who else they could find, but there's got to be somebody out there who can do color commentary better than him. And I think I made this point to you, too, previously. You know, the New Japan product is much more sports-oriented than, say, you know, your sports entertainment here in the U.S., and I don't think that a heel commentator really works all that well for the product. I think it would work better if it was, you know, a shoot play-by-play guy, like the way that Josh Barnett calls it on Access. He did an amazing job. He calls holds. He, you know, adds his two cents as being a guy who worked in Japan, worked in the promotion, is familiar with it, familiar with a lot of the talent, a lot of the athletes. He is marvelous. I think he's, you know, terrific, and if they could get him to work alongside Kevin Kelly, I think it would really boost Kevin Kelly and take a lot of the burden off of him.
Matt, would you say he's glorious?
Yes. Absolutely. And knowing his fighting spirit, I doubt he would ever give in until he's victorious.
So I had I had some company over this weekend. My lady was out of town. Doing a girls' weekend, and her best friend's husband and his boys came over, and I've taken them to a couple NXT shows, and we're just sort of hanging out. I'm like, guys, have you seen the Okada Omega match yet? Because I talked to them about it, and they hadn't. And you know, my one friend, I ended up putting it on, and he was just like enraptured, and he had to see the entire thing. So you're talking about like very like super casual fans. but you put a match on like that and it draws them in. I took the opportunity to show them a little other, you know, some other New Japan stuff. Like I showed them a Sakuraba match because his one son is a huge MMA fan, and he brought Sakuraba up. So there's a match of his that I put on. I think it was Nagata and Sakuraba. And then what else did I put on? Oh, I eventually ended up putting on the Inoki Great Antonio match, which we need to do as a little bonus clip sometime on the show because my friend asked me about it. He'd never actually seen the entire match before. So that was entertaining. And I put on the Hansen Andre match that we talked about last week.
Yeah, that's a good one. That would I'd highly recommend that one to anybody. Yeah, because that is just such a spectacle. I mean, young Andre is fucking amazing. Like I don't know if I can ever stress that enough.
Yeah, he can move. He can bump. He knows submission holds. He's very fond of doing that Kimura, which again is just such a weird sight to see.
Yeah. I do have, it's not really a bone to pick, but it's just, you know, I want to throw this out there because, you know, my man, like I just mentioned, Josh Barnett and JR have really nitpicked this point. It's a damn double wrist lock. That was their point of contention.
It's called a Kimura because it's named after an individual that broke Ricky Dozan's arm with that hold.
Okay, so that makes sense. But yeah, that's their point. It's like, you know, this is catch wrestling. It's a Kimura, damn it. So yeah, that's just that was their whole line.
I mean, I've heard. I heard Terry Funk say that in an interview once. He's like, I'm not going to try to do the Terry voice. He's like, I don't know when it became a Kimura. It was always called a double wrist lock when I did it.
Yeah.
So you can sort of imagine that.
You egg sucking dog. That's another one. JR's just, his impressions are great. I'd love to see a one man show of him. He was pushing that on the Wade Keller livecast last week or 2 weeks ago that he was putting one up on his Fight TV app. So maybe I'll spring for that sometime.
I'm kind of thinking about maybe getting up to Orlando in a couple weekends for some of the festivities. I'm trying to line it up. Haven't decided for certain yet. But there's a lot of stuff going on. I'm definitely not going to Mania, and we'll talk about Mania later in the show. But there's enough. I'm kind of thinking about.
Do we have to?
Yeah, we're going to. Sorry.
God damn it.
And actually, it might have been one of the. It might have been. A Gracie whose arm he broke with the that Masahiko Kimura, whose arm he broke with the Kimura hold.
I think that's right.
I got my facts wrong.
More accurate.
But he did have a big feud with Ricky Dozan. So.
Oh. Okay.
So anyway, so it's sort of the origins of the Kimura and mixed martial arts and BJJ and everything, and why it's called a Kimura and not a double wrist lock. Anyway, I'm sorry, I'm getting like super ADD here. Which is sort of my tendency anyway. I'm kind of thinking about going to the ROH show. I'm seeing if I can round some people up to go with me. You know, I'm not necessarily the hugest Young Bucks fan. There goes all my credibility out the window again.
But the IWC is just going to never download an episode again.
Well, they're not.
Because right. that's
they're not anyway. Right? So, I mean, we're not really losing anything.
Ouch.
Yeah.
That huge listenership we've built up over the past couple months.
Yeah. So, but that Hardy's Bucks match is going to be one for the ages. And this isn't necessarily a match to drive to Orlando for it, but it should be cool. Christopher Daniels is defending the title against Dalton Castle.
Yeah, that's that should be interesting. Not to disparage the guy at all or anything, but I haven't been very familiar with Christopher Daniels' work. Never really been a huge TNA guy. Never really got too into ROH. just because it really hasn't been available around here. I never really bought the DVDs growing up. I was sort of familiar with it on the periphery, but I never really got into it. But yeah, I mean, I'm sure that he's great. And because, you know, everybody always talks about like his three-way feud with him and Styles and Joe being like really classic stuff. And yeah, the Dalton Castle character is awesome. Just judging by the recent stuff that we covered for the podcast when they were over in Japan, I'm a big fan. I was really impressed right away with him. So that should be an interesting little style matchup.
Yeah, so we'll see what happens in a couple weekends if I make the trip up there. It's going to depend on it's probably going to be a last minute decision, and it's going to be a matter of how lazy I'm feeling. That these old bones don't really like that drive anymore.
I mean, it's, you know, who can blame you? It's you know, it's not I'm sure that traffic is pretty crazy. I'm sure it's not, you know, the most pleasant little jaunt in the world.
Traffic isn't that bad once you get outside of South Florida. It's just the distance. Although traffic probably will be crazy for Mania weekend.
Yeah, that's true.
But anyway, Matt, if you don't have anything else, let's move on to our match of the week.
Let's do it.
November 5th, 1981. A matchup between two of the legends of the wrestling business, two innovators, two gentlemen that you continue to see their influence shine through today. The competitors, Tiger Mask and Gran Hamada.
Yeah, really, really innovative, extremely influential work here between these two. I mean, the stuff, you know, I don't even know how to describe it as far as, you know, I mean, aside from, you know, your typical cliches as far as, you know, being ahead of its time and everything like that. I mean, it's really, really amazing work.
So let's kick this one. So this is the first time that we've covered Tiger Mask. We will be covering him again, but he's a pretty important figure in New Japan Pro Wrestling. And you actually see two different gentlemen today that are bearing the mantle of Tiger Mask. So let's give everybody a little background on this gimmick and the first man to wear the mask.
Okay. So as far as the Tiger Mask character is concerned, like you've mentioned, it's been held by several different wrestlers throughout the past 36, 37 years or so. The character was inspired, you know, more or less taken straight from the manga series, which was written by Ikki Kajiwara and Naoki Tsuji, if I'm pronouncing this correctly. I hope I am. So in the manga, Tiger Mask was a feared heel in the U.S., but he decided to return to Japan and become a hero because he had overheard a young boy claiming that he wanted to be a villain like Tiger Mask when he grew up. So he didn't like the fact that he was influencing the youth in such a negative way and comes back to Japan as a conquering hero. So pretty cool concept, pretty noble idea as far as the character is concerned. So the character was originally licensed by New Japan Pro Wrestling in the early 80s and given to Satoru Sayama. And the goal here was to bolster the junior heavyweight division, which it most certainly did. So for a few years, Sayama held that title and that character. And in 1984, after Sayama left the promotion, All Japan purchased the rights to the gimmick and gave it to Mitsuharu Misawa, really famed All Japan wrestler from especially the late 90s when he was working with the likes of Kawada and Kenta Kobashi. So I'm sure that, you know, Japanese wrestling fans are familiar with the name.
Yes, and it's important to point out that he actually founded NOAH, and he took a big chunk of the All Japan talent to NOAH with him. This is after the passing of Giant Baba. I don't want to get too far down the path on that, but that's a pretty important part of his legacy, apart from being Tiger Mask the second.
Indeed. So, so Misawa held that character from 84 till 1990. And then in March 92, Koji Kanemoto became the third Tiger Mask in New Japan. But the character really didn't get over too well because at the time, Jushin Thunder Liger was really dominating the division, the junior heavyweight division. And I don't think that as Tiger Mask, I don't think Kanemoto ever held the junior heavyweight title. And as a matter of fact, Kanemoto lost a mask versus mask match to Liger in January of 94. So that was the end of that iteration of the character. So then after that, Yoshihiro Yamasaki became the fourth Tiger Mask in 1995 in Michinoku Pro. And this is significant because he was directly trained and endorsed by the original Tiger Mask, Satoru Sayama. So he debuted the gimmick in New Japan again in 2002, and he still wrestles under the mask there today. So that is the same fourth Tiger Mask who's been there since 2002 and has been wrestling under that gimmick for over 20 years now. And then also, as we previously mentioned, so we have Tiger Mask 4 as well as Tiger Mask W, who is a character used to promote the new anime series in Japan, and he debuted in October 2016. And as we've hinted at previously, sort of kayfabe, but now we're gonna break the fourth wall and mention that he is portrayed by Kota Ibushi, the amazingly talented worker, both in DDT recently as well as New Japan Cruiserweight Classic WWE. If you've seen him there, he was really spotlighted there.
So, Matt, that's all rumors and innuendo. All rumors and
indeed
innuendo.
Indeed it is, yeah. Well,
think because Dave Meltzer wrote it that it's true? Sorry, I'm summoning some other podcasts. I'm sorry, I'm actually a huge fan of Mr. Meltzer, but anyway.
All right, brother love. You calm down there. All right, so yeah, We've got two iterations going on currently, two different men portraying the Tiger Mask character. So interesting time for the character, for sure. And we also have to mention, I think, that New Japan created the Black Tiger character to be a sort of doppelganger, an evil twin, to oppose Tiger Mask. And this character has been portrayed by the likes of Mark Rocco, Robert Cortez, a name we might be familiar with, Eddie Guerrero, Silver King, and another name we might be familiar with, Rocky Romero. And funny little fact here, I thought this was amusing. Tomohiro Ishii had a short run with the gimmick in 2010. So if you can imagine that, the way that man is now, as far as this big wrecking ball of a man, he used to wrestle as a junior heavyweight as the Black Tiger. So pretty funny image.
So why don't you tell us about a little bit about the original Tiger Mask? We've talked about the gimmick quite a bit, but tell us about Satoru Sayama.
Okay, so yeah, Satoru Sayama, the man who was working the Tiger Mask character during the time of this match. He was born on November 27th, 1957, and his big claim to fame as Tiger Mask was that he held both the WWF Junior Heavyweight Championship and the NWA World Junior Heavyweight Championship simultaneously, and he's the only man to ever do that. Another huge contribution in the span of his career is that he founded the Shooto promotion, a mixed martial arts promotion, as well as Saikendo, which sort of counts as its own martial art, and also the Real Japan Pro Wrestling promotion. So over the span of his career, he's started and maintained three separate promotions throughout his time. Another huge accolade for him, Bret Hart once referred to him as the Bruce Lee of wrestling, due to his, his speed, his martial arts prowess, things of that nature. So, that's high praise, as it were. Satoru Sayama debuted in New Japan in 1976. He was sent abroad to England and Mexico due to his small stature. So Seems like a common theme here. We'll talk about it again when we talk about his opponent, Gran Hamada. You know, they didn't really seem to have too much to do with these smaller guys when they first showed up in the dojo, so they just kind of sent them off. So when Sayama was in Mexico, he won the NWA World Middleweight title in the EMLL promotion. He also debuted as Tiger Mask in April 1981. And in that match, he pinned Dynamite Kid. So I believe it was with a German suplex. So we have this character coming in based off of this, you know, basically a cartoon character. And a lot of people sort of laughed it off as, oh, look at this silly thing. You know, this is never going to work. And then the guy, you know, went over on Dynamite Kid in his debut match. So really put these people on notice as far as, you know, this guy's a serious competitor. So, yeah, it was a great way to debut him. So moving forward, we have, you know, Sayama successfully competing in both New Japan and WWF. He ended up beating Dynamite Kid in Madison Square Garden as well during this run. So that's a huge accomplishment for him. And he ended up getting really fed up, though, with backstage politics in pro wrestling and retired on August 12th, 1983. So, you know, right in the middle of his prime, he's got a really hot run going. And he just up and quits. And he was holding both the NWA and WWF junior heavyweight titles at the time. So, you know, really, really bizarre circumstances for that. I think a lot of people were really shocked by that. So Sayama ended up resurfacing in the UWF in 1984. He went by the Tiger as well as Super Tiger, so two separate gimmicks that he held during that time period. And then he left that promotion in 1985. This is another interesting set of circumstances. He and Akira Maeda had a real clash as far as their styles. You know, pretty sure that Maeda really wanted to you know, be a more shoot style with the martial arts. And
I mean, that was a whole that was a whole idea of the UWF was it was supposed to be shoot style stuff.
Right. So you know, Tiger Mask didn't really take too kindly to that, and they ended up shooting on each other in the match, legit. And Maeda started kicking Sayama in the lower abdomen. And Sayama claimed to the referee that Maeda was hitting with groin shots, and therefore the referee disqualified Maeda. And then, you know, there was a big controversy over this. Several wrestlers left the UWF shortly after, and then the promotion ended up folding. So, you know, we have a lot of controversy surrounding Sayama, both in New Japan and in UWF. Seems like a really, you know, sort of a rogue character, if you will, you know, really individualistic guy, not really the best team player, perhaps. Another example of that is after he left the UWF, Sayama wrote a book called Kayfabe, which is really, you know, it's pretty responsible as far as popularizing the term kayfabe, and it really exposed the pro wrestling business as far as the Japanese audience was concerned, especially. So, yeah, I mean, he pretty much let the cat out of the bag there. So I'm sure he was probably, you know, probably ostracized by a lot of old school wrestlers for that.
On a side note, what's always silly to me about that is, yeah, so there's some, you know, inner secrets on how, like, maybe a match actually works or whatever. I have a hard time believing that much of anybody thought this stuff was real, even as a little kid when I was pretending, when I was, you know, wanting to believe, I still knew. I mean, so I don't imagine that the average person in Japan by the mid-80s thought it was a legitimate sporting contest.
Yeah, especially when you had, you know, Inoki going up against legitimate combat sports guys and beating them, you know, most of the time, so... Yeah, it would be kind of hard to suspend your disbelief after seeing that for so many years. So after he left UWF, Sayama founded the Shuto Gym and promotion in 1986. And big contribution here was that it introduced Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu in Japan and sort of integrated it into the Vale Tudo or Anything Goes. Vale Tudo means anything goes as far as the translation goes. That style of combat. So, you know, really, you know, emphasizing the submissions, and, you know, anybody who knows mixed martial arts knows how that goes. So, Sayama left Shuto in 1996 after having disagreements with their board of directors. Shocking. Guy had creative differences with other people in the promotion and ended up leaving after it. So, yeah, pretty much follows his MO. In 1995, Sayama returned to New Japan to take on Inoki. He used the Tiger King gimmick during this match, which Inoki won. And ever since then, Sayama started appearing sporadically in different Legends matches, things like that. Correct me if I'm wrong, this would have been Inoki's years-long retirement tour, right?
Yeah, I'm not for sure the retirement tour has actually ended yet.
this is true.
Much like Terry Funk.
Yeah, absolutely. So yeah, in 1999, Sayama founded the Saikendo promotion. Probably butchered that. Which he, you know, is defined as its own martial art. And he also started the Real Japan Pro Wrestling promotion in 2005. And in Real Japan, he wrestled as Super Tiger. And he really, you know, started to give back at this point. He put over all kinds of younger stars, including Shinjiro, Otani, and Minoru Suzuki, who we've mentioned before.
I mean, listen, if Suzuki wanted to go over, Suzuki was probably going to go over.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, we have two legitimate shooters in that match, though. Suzuki and Sayama, former Pancrase champion versus the, you know, founder of two separate martial arts promotions. So that would have been an interesting little shoot had they gone that way. So yeah, and then we have some sort of tragic circumstances in more recent times. Sayama was in a match with Aki Bono, who you might remember from taking on the Big Show at a WrestleMania. I don't know which one, I'm not going to lie. I was a lapsed fan during that time period, but
I
remember people talking about it. So yeah, in that match, Aki Bono hit a splash on Sayama, and it messed him up really bad, and Sayama ended up having to have emergency heart surgery. And, you know, everybody told him to stay out of the ring. But of course, you know, being a grizzled old vet as he was, he returned to the ring on June 23rd of 2016. So as far as I know, he's probably still considered an active wrestler. If he came back as recently as, you know, within the past year. So we talked about a couple of his championships that he's held, but in addition to those, Sayama has also held the Real Japan Legends title. You know, it's his promotion. He can take a Legends title for sure. As well as winning the Tokyo Sports MVP Award of 1982. He won the UWF tournament in 1984, and he was inducted into the Wrestling Observer Newsletter Hall of Fame in 1996. So pretty big honors there, especially the last one.
Indeed. So tell us a little bit about Gran Hamada, his opponent in this match.
Okay. Interesting little bit here. Gran Hamada was also born on November 27th, but of 1950. So a few years older. Gran Hamada was the first Japanese wrestler to really adopt the Mexican Lucha Libre style, which we see a lot of in this match. Really cool stuff. He was one of the first ever New Japan Dojo trainees in 1972, and it was there that he gained the nickname Little Hamada. And similar to Satoru Sayama, he was shipped off for being too small, and they sent him to the Universal Wrestling Association in Mexico, and he really got over there, and to the point where the Mexican fans and the promoters gave him the nickname Gran Hamada. So that's where that comes from. Gran means great. And yeah, so he was a pretty beloved figure there. And then he also competed at EMLL, and they just put the article the or L Gran Hamada in front of his name. So a little bit of change there. If you've ever heard of him as L Gran Hamada, that would explain that. So Hamada ended up joining the UWF in 1984 as well. And his, you know, he had the more flashy Lucha Libre base style really clash with their shoot base style, kind of similar to what Sayama experienced as well. So their careers have a lot of these little parallels. I think it's kind of funny as we go through. So after, you know, not really taking kindly to that, he ended up leaving and working for All Japan. And Hamada also ended up starting his own promotion as well, Universal Lucha Libre, which he founded in 1990. And that promotion ended up closing in 1995. So after that, Hamada joined Michinoku Pro, which was formed by former Universal Lucha Libre wrestlers. So, you know, he gave to them, and they ended up giving back to him when he needed work. It's pretty cool. And then we have another pretty big point here. Fans of the Monday Night War era might recall the ECW Barely Legal pay-per-view. Their first ever pay-per-view on April 13th, 1997, which featured a Michinoku Pro 3-versus-3 you know, trios tag match. And Gran Hamada teamed with Great Sasuke and Masato Yakushiji. Thank you, sorry. And he ended up, I don't know who out of that team won, but they ended up defeating Taka Michinoku, Dick Togo, and Men's Teo.
Men's Toa.
And that Men's Teo. Okay. Men's Toa. In that pay-per-view. So, I've seen highlights of that match before. I don't think I've ever seen it all the way through, but, I think that one was kind of famous for a few little botched spots. You know, big dives and stuff that didn't necessarily go too well. In 2001, Hamada began working for All Japan again, and was briefly a member of the Love Machines stable, which was sort of a take on the classic Machines, the Super Strong Machine, and stuff like that, the classic All Japan stable.
Where he was known as Mini Love Machine.
Awesome. So we also have, Hamada has a pretty important legacy as well. He has two daughters who are wrestlers as well. And Ayako is one of them, and the other one is a name that I will not be able to pronounce. Hochidal, I'm guessing. I'm not sure. He has two pretty accomplished daughters in the business as well. So he has several accolades that he's won throughout his career, including the International Junior Heavyweight Tag Team League in 1984 in the All Japan promotion, in which he teamed with Mighty Inoue. He won the Big Japan Heavyweight Championship once. He won the NWA World Middleweight Championship in EMLL. He won the the WWF Intercontinental Tag Team Championship with Pero Aguayo, which is a sort of funny footnote. It was scrapped pretty quickly after they started it. That's all I got. Anything you want to add to that?
Seems like you're out of breath there a little bit. That's a lot of information, Maddie.
Yeah, I had to. Well, it doesn't help with the congestion still kicking in there. I got some stuffiness up in my head, as it were. So,
all right. So the match kicks off. Gran Hamada gets a nice pop from the crowd, but a much much bigger one for Tiger Mask. The gentlemen shake hands to start off the match. This is say very much a babyface versus babyface contest. Would you agree?
Absolutely. Yeah. They both show a lot of sportsmanship throughout and even after the match. So yeah, neither of them really get too hot at each other for any of the action that took place during the match either. So yeah, it's pretty different take as far as, the matches we've seen previously, which are really really strongly contested as far as, these feuding characters. So, yeah, a little bit of a change of pace.
So the match starts off a little bit of a technical showcase. You know, we have lockups, go-behinds. Pretty early on, we have a takedown that ends up with Tiger Mask having Hamada in an armbar. And what's actually, so he sort of has the, you know how they do the armbar, they'll drape one leg over the dude's body and the other over his basically like his face, right?
Yeah.
Hamada transitions that into a stretch muffler, gets the one arm back behind his leg, and then gets Tiger Mask up off the mat, which I thought was a cool transition for that spot. Tiger Mask gets stuck in that move for a little bit, and then he actually manages to trap the arm again. Gets the arm trapped, but they both end up back standing back up. Tiger Mask has got the a wrist lock on him, and Hamada escapes just like this really quick and aggressive body slam, which is actually, you know, normally I wouldn't talk that much about body slams, but something you see in this match a few times is like these really fast and sort of like, I'd almost call it brutal body slams. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're very, you know, with the smaller stature of these guys, they're able to really quickly lift up and, you know, slam down with a lot of impact their opponents. It's definitely an important high spot that we see throughout this match. One thing I wanted to add real quick, during that first opening encounter, we see a move that we've seen a few times here, especially from Andre, where Tiger Mask has Hamada, has a hold of both of his arms from behind him, and stretching out his arms, and Hamada does this really cool flipping drop kick. He jumps backwards and flips up and over and back onto his back, and then Tiger Mask kips up immediately, so lightning quick, and they both jump up and square up with each other again. Really cool way to finish that opening sequence with all those really nice looking submission holds and counters. And yeah, really, really awesome technical opening sequence.
So after a Roman knuckle lock, Tiger Mask gets Hamada into a headlock. Tiger Mask gets whipped into the ropes, comes back with a shoulder tackle, and takes down Hamada. Hamada gets back up, and Tiger Mask is running at him. Body slams Tiger Mask, so they both attempt to sort of keep exchanging running moves, and they're like kind of avoiding it with flips or whatever. There's like a backdrop that Hamada just manages to flip out of and land on his feet. And in a really cool spot, slightly reminiscent, I think, of the Osprey Ricochet match from last year. Both guys run at each other, both go for drop kicks, and then just sort of miss. Big reaction from the crowd. You sort of, that with the running moves and the flips and the rolls to get out of the match is sort of, I guess it's obviously Ricochet and Osprey get way crazier, but that's sort of what it reminded me of.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's definitely influenced by that, by this type of stuff that we're seeing here in this match. Yeah. You can really see the influence.
So another one of the things I really liked about this match is there was a few like innovative submission holds. So Hamada at one point takes Tiger Mask down with a single leg takedown, sort of starts working the right leg, and then he transitions it into sort of like a half bow and arrow, half Boston crab. He's kind of cranking back in the leg like he's going to turn him over into a crab, and then gets a hold of one of his arms and puts a knee into his side and back and sort of starts bending him sideways.
Yeah, that's one of a few different holds that I had no idea what to call. I had no clue what the name of that submission would be. We have one pretty much immediately before that too, where Tiger Mask has one leg behind sitting Hamada and one leg in front of him, and he's again wrenching both of those arms. And judging by his position, judging by the leverage that he has, you can really see that being an effective shoot hold. Is it's not too much of a contrived thing. So really cool looking moves throughout here. Yeah, absolutely.
So Tiger Mask manages to get back up onto his feet, but Hamada still has a hold of his leg. Tiger Mask, as you would imagine, escapes with an enziguri.
Yeah, it's like this reverse kind of mule kick enziguri. It reminded me of Jeff Hardy. I think I've seen him do that style of flipping reverse enziguri quite a few times.
Yeah, it's enziguri's not quite the right name for it, but for the sake of this conversation, we'll go ahead and call it that.
Yeah, that's the closest thing we can come up with here for sure.
So, Gran Hamada nails Tiger Mask with a series of really brutal elbows, and then when Tiger Mask is down in the mat, gets him locked into a head scissors. Tiger Mask works his way out of that, and then actually rolls Hamada up into a bow and arrow.
Yeah, he doesn't really hold on to it for very long. He gives up on it pretty quickly, and then he goes to this really vicious sequence of kicks, really reminiscent of, if you're familiar with Ultimo Dragon, really reminded me of that. Some lower kicks, maybe one to the leg, one to the body, bam, bam, and then this jumping, back kick to the head. He gets a lot of elevation and gets that leg all the way up to Hamada's head. Really awesome display as far as that goes.
So Tiger Mask gets Hamada up in the crucifix position. Hamada slides off. He rolls Tiger Mask up for a pin and a one count. Hamada starts getting a little salty at this point and slaps Tiger Mask. Tiger Mask returns in kind with multiple slaps. They lock up, and then Hamada hits Tiger Mask with a throat thrust. Backdrop, of course, the announcers go wild because the backdrop is a hugely over move in Japan. Another pin from Gran Hamada and a two count.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love that. Something that, wrestling fans in the U.S. have probably become really desensitized to is still such a huge, legendary, maneuver in Japan because of that storied history that we've talked about previously. It's really cool that, a lot of these Japanese fans know their history and know the significance of that move. It's pretty cool.
And again, yeah, you still hear that move when somebody hits that belly to back suplex. The crowd pops huge for it. The announcers start yelling backdrop, backdrop. It definitely still gets a reaction from the crowd.
Mm-hmm. For sure.
So another kind of cool submission move. Gran Hamada gets Tiger Mask in like a seated abdominal stretch. Again, I don't know that I've seen that one before. Maybe I have.
Yeah. Another one that, it seems rather innovative as far as I know anyway. Yeah, I'll agree with you on that one. Tiger Mask ends up, getting to his feet, does a standing switch, hits Hamada with the big German suplex and bridges for the two count. Fans go crazy for this one. Announcers really lose it for this one too. Huge high spot, probably, one of the biggest ones of the match.
So after the German suplex, which ends up being a two count, Hamada rolls out of the ring for a bit, gets back in the ring. Tiger Mask hits him with an elbow and then a really stiff kick to the back of the head. Tiger Mask kind of goes for this awkward pinning combo.
It was sort of like a cobra twist into a crucifix. Really interesting little setup there for that.
Yeah, it was. I don't know if that was exactly what he intended. It was a little bit odd.
Yeah, and then a little bit of more really cool chain wrestling. Hamada counters it into like an Indian deathlock style of hold, and then transitions that into an STF. So we see a lot of really unorthodox countering and reversals of these holds back and forth. Really, it makes a really interesting matchup as far as that goes.
So another really cool spot. Tiger Mask gets whipped into the corner by Gran Hamada, and Tiger Mask planches off of the middle rope with a body block onto a Hamada for a two count, and they get a big pop out of the announcers for that one too. They start screaming plancha, plancha.
Really cool little sequence there. Yeah, they both go back and forth, and yeah, it ends up with that being the climax of that little exchange. Yeah, Tiger Mask is, it seems like he's especially really over here with both the fans and the announcers.
So Tiger Mask whips Gran Hamada into the ropes, and Tiger Mask does this crazy leaping back handspring thing, and both guys collide midair. This was a little bit of an awkward looking spot too. I think it was, I don't know if it was supposed to be like a double butt bump or something. It was a little bit of a train wreck, but the but that back handspring by Tiger Mask was pretty awesome. And again, is reminiscent of some of the crazy junior weights that you see today.
Yeah, I mean, we still have that. You know, we have Kushida doing that. We have even Jay Lethal doing that with his lethal injection. A lot of people probably think of Great Muta, Tajiri, and the list goes on. So, yeah, we're seeing the influence all over the place from these two. Yeah, it seemed like both men were going for, back elbow spots. Looked like, maybe Hamada was just going for a straight up spinning back elbow, and Tiger Mask was going for like a back handspring elbow, so kind of an awkward collision, but it works because both men are sort of laying there selling the effects of it for a minute, like they didn't really see it coming. So yeah.
So Tiger Mask gets Hamada down with a kick, applies a figure four, and I got a little bit of a chuckle out of this because Hamada was selling it like he was giving birth or something.
Yeah, and it's another one too where and again, it's kind of nitpicking, but Hamada seemed like he could have very easily reached that bottom rope the whole time, but he's really selling the agony of the hold, and then he just reaches up and gets that bottom rope like it was nothing, like it was there the whole time, which it was. So yeah, and like you said, Tiger Mask with another huge spinning, jumping spinning back kick to the head, really cool. Really cool looking kicks here from Tiger Mask throughout that Yakuza style kick that he hits on him earlier to the back of the head, and these different style kicks that he's using are really cool. We see a lot of more striking based wrestlers today, and I think that this is again something that we can point to as really a forerunner to that.
It's certainly part of it. So we got a really cool exchange come up next. Tiger Mask with this big high body slam on Hamada. Tiger Mask scoops him up again for another slam, but Hamada gets up on Tiger Mask's shoulders, pins him with a victory roll and a near three count. Both men are back up. Hamada hits Tiger Mask with a tiger suplex, another near pinfall. Boston Crab from Gran Hamada. Tiger Mask powers out, sort of rolls up Hamada and pins him sitting on his chest. And then Hamada rolls Tiger Mask forward for a pin of his own, but he rolls him forward too far and Tiger Mask gets his feet on the ropes.
Really cool little sequence there. Something we would see a lot of in more modern cruiserweight style matchups where you have the back and forth with the pin attempts. So yeah. Awesome stuff.
So both guys start getting a little annoyed with each other. They start exchanging blows. Hamada gets Tiger Mask down with a snapmare chin lock. Tiger Mask escapes, wrist locks him into a chicken wing, and then starts working the left arm, and then gets him into a camel clutch.
Yeah,
Hamada.
I thought that camel clutch was really funny because you see all the cameramen really rushing to that side of the ring for the photo op. That would have probably been the cover of a lot of Japanese magazines, or at least made the pages that month.
So Hamada manages to escape the hold, takes Tiger Mask down with another snapmare, but misses a big jumping elbow. Tiger Mask hits Hamada with a nasty spinning back breaker, whips him into the ropes, backdrop. Tiger Mask goes for another. Hamada flips through again like he did in earlier in the match, and then sends Tiger Mask to the floor with a pair of drop kicks, and then dives through the ropes for a tope suicida.
Yeah, and again, the announcers pop huge, the screaming tope, tope, like really really, you know, upping the intensity here towards the go home of the match.
So Hamada back in the ring. Tiger Mask gets up on the apron. Hamada drop kicks him back to the floor. Hamada goes up to the top rope and dives outside, but he misses. Both guys are hurt really bad. Tiger Mask just barely gets back in. Hamada misses a 20 count. Victory for Tiger Mask by count out.
The first time I watched this, I actually didn't notice it, but you can see Tiger Mask roll out of the way. I think he probably does a forward roll as Hamada's leaping off of the top there. You can sort of see his head duck down and go, you know, so he rolls in the same direction of the same turnbuckle from which Hamada jumps off of. So
yeah, they didn't have a good camera angle on that, and there's always a ton of chaos at the ringside with the with the handlers and the cameramen and stuff.
Yeah, if Vince were there, he would have been like, "God damn it, Kevin!" Would have been one of those moments.
So the WWE doesn't miss those shots though.
This is true.
So Tiger Mask helps Gran Hamada back in the ring, raises his arms. So really awesome show of sportsmanship. I would say overall, so unique mix of athleticism, especially from Tiger Mask. Gran Hamada had some athletic spots too, but Tiger Mask in certain points was on a different level. Also, he had some unique submission holds, some unique transitions and submission holds, some unique pinning combos. Again, we always say this when we talk about the junior heavyweight matches, it's ahead of his time, and you still see the influence of this stuff in a big way today. Not thrilled with the count-out finish. This happens in way too many of these matches that we're talking about. I think it's just a symptom of the age because you don't really see this in modern New Japan. And we kind of talked about, you know, at some point during the 80s, all Japan completely got away from this sort of finish. But I think if you're going to do a count-out finish, this is the way to do it. Both guys are hurt. Hamada hurts himself really badly on the dive from the dive outside. And then Tiger Mask just manages to barely get back in. So, again, not thrilled with the count-out, but if you're going to do a count-out, this is the way to do it.
Yeah. One thing that I really liked about this was the way that they built their match up from these really basic holds, and then you had the really the more unorthodox or really more advanced style of holds, and then they build to the high spots. So they really do a good job of starting from, you know, a lock up or a knuckle lock, and then, you know, going from there, and then every time, you know, you have a big high spot, it means a lot more because it was built up from a, you know, very basic thing every time.
So you mean there's psychology in the matches? Is that what you're saying, Matt?
Yes, absolutely. It's rather refreshing knowing, you know, the way that things go a lot of the times today. Another thing that I really like, you know, despite the count out finish, is I like how, you know, the high risk offense ended up really costing Gran Hamada in the end. You know, the way that, you know, that goes nowadays, if somebody crashes and burns, you know, that might not really have too big a consequence later on in the match, you know. So again, with the idea of the psychology really working well here, I really like how that worked too.
So got some bad news earlier this week. In case, you know, any of our listeners haven't heard this yet, I believe it was late Monday night, Jim Ross put out a tweet that his wife Jan had been in an accident. She was riding her Vespa to the gym, and she was struck by another driver. She wasn't wearing a helmet, and she received catastrophic head injuries. And catastrophic are, as JR's own words, had multiple skull fractures. She is not doing well. and they're basically waiting for the brain swelling to come down and see what happens. I mean, apparently JR was recording his podcast when this happened. So you can sort of imagine the eeriness of when I actually went and listened to the podcast, knowing that this is sort of happening in the, you know, in the background for him, and he probably doesn't know yet. This is awful, in a really serious way. This is probably one of these things I'll say and I'll piss off people. I don't like, you know, motorcycles. I don't like scooters. I had a colleague of mine get killed while riding a bicycle when she got hit by a rider. I had another colleague that was doing an Ironman and got hit by a car and broke his neck. It's just, you know what? It's a little scary. And yes, she should have been wearing a helmet. But if you're actually inside of an automobile, you don't have to worry about wearing a helmet. And, you know, Jim Ross may, you know, quite likely has lost his wife. I'm actually starting to get a little choked up talking about it. It fucking sucks in a really serious way. And, you know, I don't know what to say about it. I mean, I very greatly feel his pain, and I send out all my wishes to, you know, Jim and Jan Ross.
Absolutely. Same here. It's tough to talk about. The thing that really sticks out, in my opinion, is, you know, you mentioned his podcast, and he always closes it with the saying that, you know, our tomorrows are never guaranteed. And, you know, it's really sad to think that he probably closed his podcast with that statement and then got that news pretty much immediately afterwards. I mean, that's really, really fucked up to think about that. That's awful.
So, you know, if there's any news to report by next week, we'll certainly talk about it. And I would say, you know, keep your eye on all the typical sites to get more news. And again, you know, send your thoughts to Jim. Let him know that all of us, you know, are thinking of him and his wife.
Absolutely.
So in less serious matters, after I've really brought down the mood in the room, got a couple announcements on in inductors for the WWE Hall of Fame this year. So the first one I want to mention is, so Eric Bischoff is going to be inducting DDP, which makes perfect sense. The two guys are like best friends. Obviously, you know, Bischoff was there for DDP's rise as a top babyface in WCW. I mentioned this first because it led to an interesting story. I was listening to Wrestling Observer Radio the other night, and they had a question come in, and they actually get these questions a lot about how, you know, do you think Eric Bischoff will ever go into the WWE Hall of Fame? And Dave lost his shit a little bit, and he's like, why does anybody care about this? Anybody can go into the Hall of Fame. That's why, I kind of meant to mention this a couple weeks ago, and it slipped my mind. Like when Beth Phoenix went in and people were like having this really serious debate if she deserved to go in, and she's only going in because she's married to Edge. It's like, at that point, you have already put too much fucking thought into the WWE Hall of Fame. It is.
Yeah, I mean, it really just caters to the whims of one man.
It is literally something cool that they do WrestleMania weekend, and I've been to the Hall of Fame ceremony in person. It's awesome. I will probably watch it this weekend because there's, or not this, with the weekend of WrestleMania, because there's always like cool speeches. It's a cool moment. I have no doubt that it's an honor for the inductees. But seriously, stop debating and stop asking about who's going to go in, because it's not like, wow, is Terrell Owens ever going to go into the NF or the Pro Football Hall of Fame? You know, because there's a question there: is that ever going to happen or not? It's the WWE Hall of Fame. There's literally no criteria other than Vince McMahon.
Yeah, just out of curiosity, I don't really know the guy's stat line, but I mean, are Trio's numbers good enough?
Absolutely, he is.
Okay.
Yeah, his numbers are crazy. He is.
I knew he was amazing. I mean, I remember that, you know, from the years he was active. I just didn't know if it was like a long enough career to really.
Oh yeah, T.O. played for a very, very long time. His stats are crazy. You know, he was an asshat, so
Yeah, if you're not for person words, yeah.
And in fact, even
I,
the
I would say troubled or something, but yeah,
no, he
ass
was,
hat's a good one.
No, he was an ass. He was an ass hat. That's there's not really another way to put it. And you know, I think one of the most egregious was actually when he sort of just completely sold out Donovan McNabb and was, I think it was in a Playboy interview that he was hinting that Donovan was gay or whatever. And it's like, what the fuck does that matter about anything?
Yeah, that's pretty shady behavior.
So he,
I'll agree with you on that.
Yeah, so T.O. did himself no favors, but it still doesn't take away from the fact that he's an all-time great. And I'm sure nobody's tuning in to listen to us talk about football. So the other inductor, this is really interesting, and I'm actually looking forward to this. James E. Cornette is going to be inducting the Rock and Roll Express, which is the only logical pick to do it. But if you listen to Corny's show at all, if you've listened to any shoot interviews with him, he's very acrimonious towards pretty much everybody. But he's particularly acrimonious towards WWE. He does not speak well of his last time there. He despises Kevin Dunn. And they're going to put him in front of a live microphone. Now, I don't think Cornette's going to do anything because he knows what the moment's for. It's for Ricky and Robert. It's not for him to go into business for himself. It's interesting. What do you think about it, Matt?
I think that, you know, for me, it was something that seemed like a pretty tepid ceremony now goes to being must-watch television. I mean, I just, you know, I think that, like I said, like you said, I doubt that he would, you know, say anything too crazy, but you never know. And, yeah, I mean, he's definitely a polarizing guy. He's not one to, you know, like we just said, not one to parse words. So yeah, I mean, who knows what he'll say, but yeah.
It will be worth tuning in for. It'll be a great speech no matter what. And he might slip some stuff in there. That's why it's important to watch it live. Just so there's no chance for them to edit something out later.
Yeah, absolutely. That's extremely important. That's of the utmost.
And Cena is going to be inducting Kurt Angle, which is very appropriate. And whatever Cena comes up with, I'm sure will be pretty awesome, because when Cena is allowed to talk as a human being and is not a corporate WWE android, he's an amazing talker.
Oh, I actually didn't know about that one until you just said it. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, Cena made his main roster debut against Angle. I don't know if you've ever seen that. It was actually a pretty cool moment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've seen replays of that. Yeah, so that'll be cool.
Ricky Steamboat is inducting Rick Rude.
Nice. Yeah, they had, you know, they probably had a pretty good history with each other down in Atlanta.
Indeed. You know, in terms of other WrestleMania weekend stuff, I'm not going to rant about this long again, because I already kind of talked about this some last weekend. I am not feeling this year's WrestleMania card. WrestleMania in the past has had sort of a kid waiting for Christmas moment for me. I'm not excited about it. And I'll tell you one reason I'm not excited about it. It's going to be a fucking 7-hour show. And I remember how tired and mad I was waiting for that fucking Reigns Hunter match to end.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was not pleasant. We had a whole group of friends around, and we were just groaning at the TV, just waiting for it to end. Like you said, yeah, it was such a drag, for lack of a better word. And yeah, I mean, like I, for once, had some WWE TV on. I mean, I had Raw on in the background, watching matches for this podcast, doing research for this podcast, and would glance at it every now and then. And it just, I don't know. I mean, it seems like they have no more momentum. They've built up everything they're going to build up, and you know, it goes to show. I mean, I'm pretty sure that you know, the ratings weren't so hot this week for Raw, and, you know, that would explain a lot. Just knowing that, you know, the whole deck has been, you know, shuffled where it's going to be, and, you know, there's no real new developments. And, yeah, it's just, you know, really, really tepid stuff all around.
Something I do want to rant about, and I'm going to echo Wade Keller's words a bit, and this is a thought I have had independently on my own. I'm not just echoing him. The way they treat Mick Foley on air, and, you know, I guess you could call me a mark that I'm taking it seriously. I don't enjoy the fact that they take this glee in belittling him because he's all crippled up and he has a hard time remembering stuff. You know, WWE made a ton of money off of Mick Foley and his sacrifices. Triple H is not Triple H without Mick Foley. They have two trilogies of matches that are all-time classics that essentially made Hunter, that got him over. And I'm sure he hates that this fat, hairy guy that's missing an ear is largely responsible for his success. So you have this guy who is beat up physically and mentally from his time in the ring. Again, helped make this company what it is today. Helped make the guy that's going to run the company eventually who he is today. And they just love tearing him down when the reason that he's in the state that he's in is because of his time with that company.
Yeah. And it's just so like, and you know, like what's the point? Like, what are they gaining from it? Like, that's the thing that really bugs me. Like, if they were getting really good heat from it, that would be one thing, but they're not. They're just, you know, it's all go away heat. Like, it's all like, you're just being condescending for the sake of it. And yeah, it's really not helping you or your character at all. You know, especially Stephanie McMahon, and she does it to everybody. Like, it's just, you know, she never gets her comeuppance. She never, you know, and this has been bantered about, you know, endlessly. So probably shouldn't get too in depth with it, but yeah, it's just, it's insane.
Well, I literally never need to see her on my television again.
Yeah. It's painful to watch every time she's on screen.
Well, Maddie, is there anything else you would like to add before we call it an evening?
No, not really. There was one point that Britt Whitmire made today on Katie Vick is Alive that I really thought was
salient. Do you want to talk about Paige any, or should we just leave that alone?
This is going to be the extent of it for me.
Okay.
I don't want to go too in depth with it. I just want to say that, you know, fuck all these meathead bros online who are slut-shaming her. Like, fuck them, seriously. Like, I'm so fucking sick of the bro culture. Like, it's sickening.
Yeah, there's a lot of things I could say about it, and I'm not going to because that's not the point of this podcast. But as soon as I started, I was sort of a little out of it for a couple days, and I see, like, you started sending me the memes, and I'm like, what the fuck is going on here? And, that, you know, found out what was going on. I'm just like, I can just imagine the shit that she's going to get about this. And of course, you know, Brad Maddox and Xavier Woods are fucking heroes, and she's, you know, she's a filthy whore.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, seriously, fuck that.
Well, with that, we bid you a good evening, and we'll see you next week.